From the Germantown campus of Montgomery College, Montgomery College Television is proud to present NJCAA College Baseball with the Montgomery College Raptors welcoming the Seahawks from Cecil College of Maryland. Hi, everybody. I'm Michael Brown, and as always, it is my pleasure to welcome in my partner, Marcus Rosano. Marcus, great to be back together again. I know we're both excited to be here at Germantown because this is when baseball really gets interesting.
You know, every year it seems like the regular season is basically an extended preseason because the season starts at playoff time. And as always, it's good to be alongside you, the voice of Montgomery College Athletics.
Well, it is hard to believe, but with today's doubleheader, we're in the final week of the regular season. The playoffs are right around the corner. And as usual, it looks like the Raptors are ready to make another deep run into the playoffs. Currently, they are 24-11 on the season, and they're in second place in Maryland JUCO.
And we welcome a Cecil team that is in fourth in Maryland JUCO at 13-9. So today's twin bill is chock full of league title implications.
Well, of course, the Raptors would like to win the league championship, but getting back to the World Series is really the goal for this team. To do that, they need to win both the Region 20 championship and also the District D championship. And on paper right now, it looks good for them to take them both and head back to the World Series.
You're right. The Raptors are the odds-on favorites. Right now, they stand in first place in Region 20, and only Westmoreland has a record above 500.
And should they win their ninth Region 20 championship in the last 11 years, then they would advance to the District D championship. They'll take on the winner of the NJCAA Region 10 championship in that one. It'll be on the road. It'll be a chance to go back to the World Series. And already this year, they've played two of their possible opponents in that District D championship.
You're right. They split with Rockingham and they split with Thomas Nelson Community College. But they haven't played Danville yet. And on paper, it looks Danville like they are the favorites to win their district. So if the chips fall where we think they might, we might be looking at Montgomery College versus Danville for the opportunity to play in the World Series.
Well, and I don't think there's any question that this team has the talent necessary to compete with any team they take on in the postseason. Offensively, they don't back off from anybody. They are loaded from top to bottom.
You know, and we were just standing behind Brooks Carson, their first baseman power hitter, and that's a loud ping off of his bat. You know, right now, he is second in the country in home runs. He's got 9, leads MC in home runs and RBIs. So that's a serious power hitter. But then you look at the number 2 hole, and there's a nice surprise in Stuart Paz. The sophomore is hitting .358. He's second on the team in RBIs, and he's got a little pop in his bat. And as you can see, this home run he hit against Garrett Community College. But the most pleasant surprise, in my opinion, is the newcomer, Pedro Mateo. He is second on the team in home runs with 7, and he's hitting .421. So this team is definitely loaded.
And on the mound, the Raptors have that one player that every team wants. They have that ace, that stopper, that guy that can come in and win that first game of any short postseason tournament. And for the Raptors, that's Harry Thomas III.
You know, Harry Thomas has been nothing short of dominant. He's 9-0 on the mound this year. That's good for number one in the country. He's got 5 complete games, and his ERA is .95. So at the top of your rotation, you have a legitimate ace as you head into the regional and hopefully the district playoffs.
Well, unfortunately, we're not going to see Harry Thomas pitch today as the Raptors turn their attention to D2 Cecil. Now, on paper, you put their stats side by side, head to head. The Raptors look like they have the advantage. But, you know, I was talking to Dan Rasher, MC's head coach, the other day, and he said, don't sell Cecil short. They play one of the toughest schedules in the entire country. And you and I have seen enough Maryland JUCO baseball over the years to know that the game's not decided on the stat sheet.
Indeed.
So we are looking forward to a very entertaining afternoon of Maryland JUCO baseball. Stick with us. Marcus and I are coming right back with the starting lineups and the first pitch of the afternoon. You're watching Montgomery College Baseball on MCTV.
No matter where you're headed, no matter what your age, you'll find it all here at Montgomery College. Small class sizes, flexible scheduling, over 130 programs of study, award-winning faculty, nationally ranked NJCAA athletics. The possibilities are endless at Montgomery College. Register today for summer session classes.
Back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. Michael Brown alongside Marcus Rosano. Our doubleheader underway, so let's take a look at the lineup for Cecil. And there's a couple of guys that are really going to jump out at us there. The first baseman, Joseph Cirelli, he's got 9 home runs. He leads the team in RBIs. And then you got Nick Ripken, hits right behind him in the batting order. He leads the team in batting average with 427 batting average. The head coach is Charlie O'Brien. He's in his 18th year. His assistants are Bub Craig, Kenny McGrady, Marty Sessa, Rod Williams, Garrett Crestwell, and Josh Hampton.
And on the hill for the Raptors in game one is Drew Stone. He's making his third start of the year. He's got no decisions on the season, but he has a 2.00 ERA, 9 innings pitched overall. Right off the bat, we have a single off of Mr. Stone.
And that was by the leadoff hitter, Dionel Infante.
And in Drew Stone's last outing, he was 13 days ago, so he hasn't been on the hill in a while. Gave up 2 earned runs over 4 innings in a start against Dundalk. And MC went on to score 4 in the 7th inning of that game and won 9-8 as closer Kamen Hatton got the win.
And that brings up number 4, Julian Lopez. So one pitch, one hit, and there's a called strike on a breaking pitch. So Drew Stone on the mound. He is throwing to his brother. So we have an all-Stone battery here in game one. Drew Stone starting on the hill. Jeff Stone behind the plate. So we are underway here on the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. It's a very cloudy, overcast, and sort of chilly day.
Chilly, here. I'll say. I forgot my jacket.
We found that out in the pregame. There's an attempted steal. The throw is late. So Infante steals a base. That's his 5th stolen base of the season.
And again, let's not let the records fool you here. This Cecil Seahawks baseball team is really good. I mean, even just watching them in warm-ups, you and I discussed the fact that they really passed the eye test with some athleticism, size. They just look like a well-rounded baseball team. And as you mentioned, they play one of the best schedules in the country.
So 1 ball, 2 strikes now to Lopez. And that's high. Now, I was talking to Dan Rasher yesterday, and he told me, listen, their record really doesn't mean anything. He said they're the best D2 program in Maryland JUCO. And he says they play, year after year, they play one of the toughest schedules in the country. And when you look at their schedule, they don't shy away from anybody. So Julian Lopez at the plate is a 217 hitter. And he swings and misses, and ball gets away, but Stone throws him out at first. So that's the first out of the inning, and that brings up Zeroli. And this is their power guy. And I'm not sure why Drew Stone or Jeff Stone threw that to first, because the ball did not hit the dirt. Caught it.
Well, the umpire actually signaled that he didn't make the catch on the fly. So.
All right, so Zeroli up. He's a 342 hitter. Got 9 home runs, 33 runs batted in.
Speaking of the eye test, this kid is a monster.
Man, I don't know what we don't have heights and weights on these guys, but he is a big fella. Actually, we do. I take that back. He is 6'4". He's listed at 6'4", 225. He's a freshman. So That's a big 18 or 19 year old. So one out here, top of the first inning. We're just underway. Doubleheader baseball. Because it is a doubleheader, both games will be seven innings in length. Unless, of course, the NJCAA mercy rule comes into effect after five.
Stone goes 3-0 on Zeroli with that base open. I mean, there's really no reason to play with Zeroli. And he's hitting 342, you know, not just the nine home runs. 342, and he's got 38 hits and 111 at-bats, and nine of them went over the fence.
Does have 26 strikeouts on the year, leads the team in that category. And he takes a strike on a breaking pitch. So Drew Stone on the hill, he is a freshman. As we said, his brother is the catcher. And they both went to Reservoir High School. Hometown is Laurel, Maryland. And he walks him. So Zeroli walks, puts men on first and second, and that brings up number 22, Nick Ripken.
And all he's doing is hitting 427 this year. One of the top hitters in the entire NJCAA Division III. He's got seven home runs. So this punch here of Zeroli and Ripken have really put up numbers for the Seahawks.
He's third in Maryland JUCO, and hey, there's an attempted steal. Throw is wide, and that's a double steal.
And that was a good jump that Dio Infante got. And I believe it was a breaking ball, too, so that makes it even more difficult for Jeff Stone to throw him out at third.
So Ripken now with two runners in scoring position, one down, top of the first.
And you have one of the best hitters in Maryland right now with second and third, one out.
There's a pop fly out of play.
He's got a pretty good last name for being up north of Baltimore.
Not spelled exactly the same way. He's another freshman. They have a young team. There's a ground ball to third. Mateo looks the runner back, throws across the diamond for one, throw to third, not in time.
And Mateo made a nice play as Brooks Carson's throw back to third went down in the dirt, and Pedro used all of that number 10 to smother it.
And Infante scores on the fielder's choice ground out.
And that was Greg Brown at first base, not Brooks Carson, I should say. Yep, that is that lefty.
So a run in, and that brings up number 21, Tovine Potts. He's the shortstop. He fouls it out of play. So Cecil jumps out to a one-run lead. Single, a couple of stolen bases, and Infante scores on a fielder's choice grounder. Our umpires today behind home plate is Dave Lawrence, and out on the bases is Willie Ayling. There's a hard ground ball to short. Peguero with it, picks it over to first for the out. So after one half inning of play, Cecil on top, 1-0, as they get the one run after getting two on and nobody out. So a pretty good job by Drew Stone to avoid further trouble, and we're going to keep it right here. We're going to take a look at the Raptors batting order with the Raptors coming up. Of course, we talked in the pregame about what a potent offensive lineup this is for the Raptors. We talked about Carson, Paz, and Mateo in the pregame. They hit 324 as a team, but they're not the only weapons by any means. You got leadoff man Chris Heckhouse. He's hitting 402 with an on-base percentage of 469.
You got Greg Brown. He's hitting 372 with 27 ribbies. And then Eddie Pagero, who just made the third out there in the top of the first. He's had a really solid season at the plate. He's hitting 333.
And, of course, the head coach of the Raptors is Dan Rasher. He's in his 11th year. His assistants are John Silk, Andy Hoy, and Justin Key Balfour, and a familiar face, Greg Turlick, former Raptors player for Coach Rasher.
And what a record head coach Dan Rasher has compiled here in his 11 full seasons, almost 11 full seasons at Montgomery College. There you see it. A winning percentage of 628. Tons of players sent on to four-year schools with scholarships. He's taken the Raptors to the D3 World Series 8 times in his 10 seasons. And, Marcus, I wouldn't bet against them going back again this year.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to have their work cut out for them in districts. But, you know, once the regular season is over, it's regional time and then it's district time. And it's basically Dan Rasher setting up his team to make the playoff run to the World Series. And on the mound is a right-hander, Iber Romero. He's the ace of the Cecil Seahawks, and he's got some pretty good numbers. He's got a 2.77 ERA. He's got 68 strikeouts in 52 innings pitched.
Wow.
And he's got 8 games started so far this year. So that is their ace.
Yeah, so we are seeing the best they have to offer. And he's facing Chris Heckhouse, the leadoff hitter. And he hits a sharp grounder to second base, over to first for one out. And that brings up number two, Eddie Pagero for the Raptors, the shortstop. Pagero's hitting 333 on the year, and he's second on the team in stolen bases with 9. Chris Heckhouse, who we just saw, leads the team with 13. So Romero quickly jumps ahead of Pagero, one strike. Ground ball up the middle of the shortstop. He fields it cleanly, long throw for the out. So two up, two down. And that brings up Stuart Paz, who we talked about in the first, in the pregame. Get another look at that one.
Potts makes a nice throw. I like Romero's lineup. It's a windup, no frills. Just take a step back and throw.
Stuart Paz, who Dan Rasher considers one of the best hitters on the Raptors team. He said he can hit the hard stuff. He can hit the breaking stuff. And, of course, he's hitting 358. 34 runs batted in. With all the power the Raptors have on this team, their little second baseman is second on the team in RBIs.
Yeah, 34 RBIs, and he's only got 2 home runs. That is some timely hitting for Stuart Paz. But that also says that the guys like Heckhouse and Eddie Pagero, they're getting on in front of him.
He takes a strike there.
And you also take into the fact that he's got Brooks Carson standing behind him, and then Greg Brown standing, and then Pedro Mateo after that. So he's getting his pitches, and he's making them count.
There's a ground ball to short. Potts, long throw for the out. So 3 up, 3 down for the Raptors. A quick first inning, and after one complete inning of play, Cecil on top, 1-0. And, you know, Marcus, I came out to Raptors practice just the other day and interviewed all the second-year players. I asked him all the standard baseball stuff, but I also asked him a few fun questions just to get to know him a little better. And one of them was, what's their favorite baseball superstition?
It might sound weird, but I'll just take a shower before every game, loosen up the muscles and everything.
I say don't cross the bats, and before every game, I iron my uniform, my jersey. So that's a little something special.
Superstition? I gotta just put my socks on like a certain way. Like I go left first and right. It's just something weird with my socks. I don't know what it is.
I guess not stepping on the line.
I would say probably getting Chick-fil-A before the games. I love getting, you know, my pregame meal of 12 chicken nuggets and then coming to the field and strapping it up and ready to go?
I don't have one, honestly.
Stepping on chalk. Before every inning you see, when I run out, I always kind of hop over the chalk or not try to step on as much as possible. But usually I do that in between innings when I'm coming in from the outfield or when I'm running out to it.
Superstition. I don't really have any, you know. Don't cross the bats. That's it. You know, don't really have any.
You know, well, always never want to walk on the lines before a game. And always if I say something I don't really mean or I get say something, I always knock on wood that I don't, yeah.
And we are back to action. Some interesting superstitions there, Marcus. We'll get back to that in a second.
Showers and Chick-fil-A. And of course, you never step on the lines.
And crossing the bats.
That's right. But one thing with stepping on the lines, you better be careful when you come down after jumping over those lines.
That's right.
You don't want any freak ACL accidents out here.
All right. So leading off for Cecil is the shortstop, Potts.
Actually, I think we have Trey Allen.
I'm sorry. It's Trey Allen. My mistake.
Long fly ball to Heckhouse in right field.
And that brings up number seven, Cameron Nye, the catcher. And he's hitting 0-53 for the year. I'm sorry. He's hitting 254 for the year. Wow. I just added 200 points to his batting average. There's a hard ground ball to short. Peguero over to first for the out. That brings up number 12, Taggart Hess. So two up, two down very quickly here in the top of the second. And
Taggart's hitting 264, lefty on lefty. He's got some pop in his bat, four home runs and 20 RBIs.
And he pops it up, out of play. Not a lot of foul ground here at Windy Hill Park on the Germantown campus. And uncharacteristically, it's not very windy today. We've been up here when the flags have just been straight out with the wind. Has the propensity to shift direction. But so far today, very calm. And considering how chilly it is, that's probably a good thing.
I'll agree with that.
And he swings right through that one. Hess is another freshman for Cecil. Cecil played a doubleheader yesterday against Delaware Tech. They split. There's a breaking pitch. Ooh, just missed. I think Drew Stone thought he had strike three.
Yeah, that curved probably about 5 inches off the plate.
And that brings up number five, Jonathan Eldreth, the left fielder. Pitches high and outside. So after two outs here in the top of the second, Hess draws a walk to keep the inning alive. Cecil on top, 1-0. There's a throw over. That was pretty close.
That was close.
I think nice swipe tag by Greg Brown.
I think he surprised Taggart Hess on that. Drew Stone did.
Good look at Willie Ayling, the base umpire today. Foul back. At this level, they go with two umpires. They're obviously a plate umpire and then a base umpire who will move around the infield depending on where runners are on base.
Eldrith, the left fielder, is hitting .286 on the season.
Seven ribbies, does have one long ball, and three doubles. So two outs in the top of the second. First game of our doubleheader. We are coming to you live on Channel 10. MCTV Channel 10, and also live over the internet.
At montgomerycollege.edu/raptorslive. You can watch us from Alaska. I felt like Alaska a little bit when I got here this morning.
It did.
10 something. But you're right, I'm glad it's not windy today.
You could watch us all over the world, and of course, MC with a pretty international roster, so I'm sure some folks are getting to see their relatives play today that normally would not have that opportunity. So this is the first year we've been able to do this, and it's been a great thing for us.
See if Drew Stone can come back, falling down 3-1 to Eldrith.
And he loses him.
He's really been away off the plate to the right-handed batters with that fastball.
So we are back at the top of the order again as Infante will come to the plate. He singled his first time up, stole two bases, and then scored the one Cecil run on the fielder's choice grounder to Mateo.
You know, Drew Stone doesn't need me to tell him this, but you don't want to walk the 8 and 9 batters in this lineup.
No, that's for sure. Not with the power that they have in the middle of the order.
That's two very nice pitches to get out in front. You know, Infante saw the first pitch that that Stone threw him in the first at bat.
Yep, he singled it sharply. Runners are moving. There's a throw to third, and they call it a strike three. So Infante takes a called third strike. Stone gets out of that one with no further damage. So after an inning and a half of play, Cecil on top, 1-0. And let's go back to my interviews with the Raptor sophomores. Now, obviously, all these guys have been playing baseball forever. So when I talked with them, I asked them what their favorite baseball memory was.
Probably going to Cooperstown when I was a 12-year-old. Going, that was a great experience down there, like getting to meet a bunch of different teams from over America, like 109 teams, I'm pretty sure. That was a great experience, really impacted my life for baseball.
Getting to the World Series last year and playing in that Herkimer game, it was a great game. You know, we came up a little bit short, but the emotions of that game were just unspeakable.
Marcus, a little bit of kind of both ends of the spectrum there, from Little League to last year's World Series.
That Herkimer game was fantastic. I remember last year, I believe I was sitting outside on my porch watching that on the computer because it was up in Herkimer, of course. And, you know, Herkimer is as good as it gets when it comes to National Junior College Athletic Association sports, and I think we've got a pretty nice rivalry with Herkimer, whether it be in soccer and seeing them in the World Series last year. But who knows, maybe that memory will come back again in reality this year for Brooks Carson.
Well, and here is Brooks leading off the inning for the Raptors. That was, I had the privilege to travel with the team last year down to the World Series in North Carolina. I covered that game. That was a heck of a ball game. Went extra innings. A couple of very difficult calls went the other way for the Raptors, which frankly I think helped was a contributing factor in the extra inning loss. But boy, did they play hard that day. They came from behind. It was a great ball game to watch and cover, but man, that team was exhausted at the end of that game, as was yours truly. So Brooks Carson to the plate, 305 batting average. Of course, we talked about him leading the team in home runs and also in RBIs. 9 home runs, 37 ribbies for the big fella.
Got a slugging percentage of .648. That's pretty impressive.
And he goes down swinging.
That was a nice spot by Romero. A little bit down and in. Brooks Carson wants to get those arms extended. He doesn't want to have to bring him in down at his ankles.
So that brings up number 27, the lefty, Greg Brown. We talked about Greg earlier. He's a freshman. And he is a 4.0 student for the Raptors. Raptors actually have two of their starters today have 4.0 GPAs, Greg Brown and Nolan Gilbert, the center fielder. So can't get any better than that. Hard ground ball to second. Nice hop. Easy play.
And Greg Brown from Rockville High School. So keeping two it up, local.
Two up, two down. And that brings up Pedro Mateo. And you talked about him being one of the most pleasant surprises for the Raptors this year.
You know, it's funny. I kind of thought about that. You know, we say pleasant surprise because it's a surprise to us. But, you know, a guy like Pedro Mateo is on this team for a reason, and Dan Rasher knows that reason. And the kid can flat out hit.
And he's a local product. He transferred in from Grambling, but graduated high school from Woodrow Wilson in D.C. So he's a local guy, decided to come back to play for Montgomery College this year.
You know, it says something about this program because you got a kid that comes from Woodrow Wilson in D.C., and Woodrow Wilson's a great high school, and goes to Grambling and then finds his way into a Raptors uniform. And that really says a lot about the reputation that this program has.
And he walks.
Number 31.
So he draws a two-out walk, and that brings up Jeff Stone.
First base runner for the Raptors.
So Jeff Stone steps in. He's hitting .328 on the year, doing a great job behind the plate. And he takes a ball.
Romero throws pretty hard out of that compact delivery. The ball pops right out of his hand.
And there's a strike. Evens the count at 1-1. Two outs here in the bottom of the second.
I think his fastball tails a little bit inside on the right-handed batter as well.
And he's ahead in the count. Other than walking Mateo, he's been throwing a lot of strikes. He's worked very efficiently here into the bottom of the second. Again, of course, Cecil is a Division II program. The Raptors are a Division III program, but of course, they're both in Maryland JUCO. Maryland JUCO, a combination of all three NJCAA divisions, 1, 2, and 3.
And Romero really wanted that curveball for strike three. Count goes full to Jeff Stone.
The fly ball into the gap, and that's going to make it all the way to the wall. Here comes Mateo around third, and he will score easily. So a two-out double by Jeff Stone to bring in Pedro Mateo. And Romero, who was sailing through the second inning, allowed that walk, and then Stone makes it pay.
He put that right out over the plate, a little bit outside, and Jeff Stone pretty much went with it into the gap. And that was a no-doubter. That was perfectly placed into the gap. And Pedro Mateo isn't exactly Ricky Henderson, but he scored with ease.
And that brings up Naha Garcia, the left fielder.
Well, that was a nice way to get your 15th RBI, Jeff Stone.
Boy, that is for sure a two-out RBI double.
We had Najah's little brother, Kevin, in here a little while ago, checking out some of the equipment. He says he wants to take your job someday, Michael Brown.
Well, I'll tell you what, he seemed very comfortable. He seemed very comfortable here in the booth. And Naha is hitting 368. Starting to get some playing time. There's a fly ball into the gap, and that is in there. That's off the wall, and Jeff Stone cruises into the plate as Naha Garcia sends it all the way to the left center field fence. So back-to-back two-out RBI doubles by the Raptors, and they're on top all of a sudden, 2-1.
Those are the two mistakes from Romero. Those are the first two mistakes he's made. I'm sure it's only the second inning, but those are two mistakes, and those are two doubles, and it's two runs.
And that brings up Nolan Gilbert, and this is a guy we've been looking forward to seeing for a long time. He was injured after the fifth game of the season. I happened to cover that game for the Raptors that day against Southern Maryland. He made a great catch in center field. But he hurt himself the next day and has not played since. So this is his first game back in the lineup since way back in March.
Yeah, he only has 15 at-bats so far this year.
Yeah, he was off to a great start. He was hitting 333. And let me tell you, he can go get the ball in center field. Dan Rasher's been really looking forward to getting him back in the lineup. He says he's really going to make a difference with their outfield defense.
And he's 2-2 against Romero, and I think Romero's pretty upset. So he's going to rear back and throw this ball, try to throw it through his catcher.
And
he comes with the breaking ball.
So Naha Garcia on second base. That was his third RBI of the season, so probably his biggest. And Gilbert swings and misses. So we have played two complete innings of play, and the Raptors have taken the lead 2-1. And we'll be right back with the top of the third after a quick break. You're watching MC Raptors Baseball on Montgomery College Television.
My favorite thing about Montgomery College is their commitment to excellence.
The support that we have from our teachers and our colleagues is amazing.
They really wanted me to pursue my goals and to graduate and to go beyond.
The small class sizes and everything was very hands-on.
Our teachers are hands-on on the students. They are there and they are available at any time.
They just want you to succeed. I love everything about Montgomery College.
And welcome back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. Michael Brown alongside Marcus Rosano. And there we get a look at the score. It's a big weekend for Raptors softball. And as we speak, we see the results of game one of the Region 20 tournament. The Raptors, boy, I tell you, you can't start the Region 20 tournament in any better fashion as they win the first game against the number 3 seed, 15-2.
That should be right now it's not a final, but that should be a mercy pretty soon.
It is, and now they will play again this afternoon. They will play the number 1 seed
Westmoreland, if they win that game, of course. It looks like they're closing in on the mercy rule. We're kind of jumping ahead here, but 15-2 in the fifth inning. But if they do hold on to win that game, they will play Westmoreland later on this afternoon. The tournament continues tomorrow with the losers of today's games playing the first game and then the championship game after that. So we'll have live updates throughout the afternoon as the Raptors softball team is down in Anne Arundel in the Region 20 softball tournament. Of course, if they win that, then they will go on to a district championship game against the combined Region 15 and 21 tournament winners.
Well, Julian Lopez wanted to take his free pass to first base. Got called back. He was a victim of a swing and a miss strikeout in the first inning.
So here we are, top of the third, Raptors on top, and Lopez does draw that walk.
Wow, what a turnaround with that softball team this year.
Boy, they won one game last year.
Could you imagine, it's not only the softball team, but the men's basketball team won three games. And we know that the men's basketball team went and won the Maryland JUCO Tournament Championship. And now you look at the softball team, and you're talking two historic turnarounds in the same year.
Yeah, the men's basketball team went from three. Oh, they got him picked off. There's the throw to second, and he is out at second base as Stone just picked him off. Let's get another look at that one. Boy, he just
he was reading movement, and
he read it wrong. And Zeroli hits a high fly ball to right field. Heck house under it for the out.
And that wasn't dangerous because Windy Hill isn't windy today.
Very unusual. So two quick outs now, courtesy of the pickoff and the pop fly to right field. And that brings up Ripken. He has the one run batted in today so far for Cecil. His fielder's choice grounder in the first scored Infante, and he fouls it down the line.
I can't get over his stat line. 38 hits and 89 at-bats coming into today's game.
The number three hitter in all of Maryland JUCO. He's up there in home runs, too. Tied for 11th in the league.
Stone confused him a little bit on that breaking ball. Ripken shaking his head.
And that's outside.
Drew hit his brother's glove, but Jeff was set up a little bit outside. Couldn't frame it in.
There's a pop up behind first base over his paws, and he gets it. The ground slopes a little bit there, plus it's a little bit wet. He almost lost his footing, but he made the catch. So after 2.5 innings of play, the Raptors still on top, 2-1. And Marcus, let's take another look at those interviews I did with the Raptors players the other day, because we have a few more of their favorite baseball memories that we'd like to share with everybody.
When I was like 13, I was playing in a tournament back home in the Dominican Republic, and I hit a walk-off to win the tournament.
Favorite baseball memory would probably be hitting my first home run last year. That was my first time ever in 15 years playing baseball, so that was kind of big for me. It was in the district championships against Rockingham. It was the second game, 3-1 pitch, went with a fastball, took it left center. So it's pretty big for me, honestly.
Wow, what a memory for Chris Heckhouse, huh?
Well, fantastic. I was there that day shooting that game, and that was a big hit as the Raptors took two straight, swept the District D tournament 2-0 over Rockingham last year. Of course, we talked about that in the pregame. This year they will go down to the Region 10 winner to play that best of three district tournament. So,
And lo and behold, here's Chris Heckhouse to lead things off for the Raptors in the bottom of the third.
The Raptors got to Iber Romero in that second inning with two long doubles in the gap.
And Chris Heckhouse is 0-for-1. He grounded out to second base his first time up. And he hits one into the gap on the line. And nice catch over there. Nice running catch by the left fielder Eldreth.
Yeah, but he couldn't have hit that ball any better.
Boy, he hit it right on the nose. Right on the button. But there's Eldreth over there to make the catch right in front of the All-American signs.
And you know, Romero is leaving those pitches up. That's another one that was right in the wheelhouse, so to speak. And that's the same type of thing that happened to him on the two doubles that the Raptors hit.
That brings up Eddie Peguero.
And these are serious hitters here. Montgomery College can swing the bat. And when you make mistakes to these guys, you're seeing what's happening.
Peguero 0-for-1. He grounded to short his first time up. He bunts it, but it's foul and out of play.
Boy, Peguero's done such a nice job at shortstop this year. And we always talk about how important it's been for the Raptors to find a strong middle infield, and this is the year that they've gotten it with Paz and Peguero.
It's so important not to give up those extra outs as Eddie Peguero swings right through that one for strike three. That brings up Stuart Paz, the other half of their middle infield combo. Right through it. Nice pitch by Romero.
Yeah, and that's where Romero has to stay. Down, down, down. He gets that ball up. I don't care how hard he throws it. These guys can hit.
So Stuart Paz, he also grounded out to shortstop his first time up. And he fouls it back.
Started Stewart off with two straight breaking balls.
Bottom of the third inning from Windy Hill on the Germantown campus.
Came back with the heat. Paz brings the count to 1-2.
Good look at Romero. There's a fly ball down the right field line. It's foul and out of play. Right fielder Hess gave it a good run, but there's a lot. That's the one part of this ballpark where there's a ton of foul ground. That's down the right field line. Not much down the left field line. Or on the third baseline. Very little. And another foul. That one is out of play down the first baseline. Chilly day here on the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. And Paz fouls it back.
Romero's getting a nice shiny baseball.
Brand new one. Well, it's a little bit, actually the tarp did a pretty good job of keeping the infield in good shape, but we've had a wet week here in the area.
And the Montgomery College grounds crew, AKA the baseball team, did a nice job on the field as well.
And that is for sure. We've talked about that probably every time we've been here. These guys not only play ball here, but they become part-time groundskeepers when you're on the Raptor baseball team. They were all out there raking and fine-tuning the infield and lining the field, and it's a team effort here from start to finish when they put a baseball game on.
Our man Sam Scheinman had a little cup with some white lime powder to fill in some cracks. These guys are turning into perfectionists out there.
Well, they work hard on this field, and I've got to say this year it looks about the best I've ever seen it look. There's a hard ground ball to third base. Nice backhand stop. Long throw, and it gets away. And there goes Paz. He'll coast into second and actually make the turn. So he reaches on an error.
Trey Allen made a heck of a stab on a short hop line drive to the backhand, and he had a lot of time, and I think he just probably could have taken another step.
Yeah, he had plenty of time because that ball got to him in a hurry on the one hop. So that brings up Brooks Carson. He struck out his first time up. So the Raptors get a man on second now with two outs in the bottom of the third. And this is the leading home run hitter for the Raptors. So Romero definitely doesn't want to get it up to Brooks Carson. We've seen what can happen when he gets it up in the zone. This is a guy who can send it a long way. He hits a hard ground ball single up the middle. Paz rounding third, and he scores. So a two-out RBI single for Brooks Carson as Stuart Paz scores it.
That's a good piece of hitting by Brooks Carson. I mean, we've seen him hit the ball out to Route 118, which is no joke. And then he just put that ball right back up the middle.
Get another look at it right up the middle. Sharply hit. So another two-out RBI for the Raptors. That's three. All three of their runs have scored after two are out, and that brings up Greg Brown, who grounded out his first time up to second base. He's unhappy with himself for going around on that high pitch to fall behind in the count. Takes another strike, so he's quickly behind in the count. No balls, two strikes.
He's been another one of the pleasant surprises that we've seen. Greg Brown has hitting 372.
He was an all-county player at Rockville High School. He grounds it back to Romero, who makes the stop, flips it over to first for the out. After three complete innings of play, the Raptors on top, 3-1. We're going to take a quick break. More Raptors baseball coming up after this.
No matter where you're headed, no matter what your age, you'll find it all here at Montgomery College. Small class sizes, flexible scheduling, over 130 programs of study, award-winning faculty, nationally ranked NJCAA athletics. The possibilities are endless at Montgomery College. Register today for summer session classes.
And welcome back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. And what we're looking at here is a first pitch thrown by Gory Javon. Gory is the trainer for Raptors baseball and also a number of other sports here at Montgomery College. And I am so sad to report that Gory is going to be leaving the college to pursue other professional opportunities. I'll tell you what, personally, I'm going to miss her a great deal. There she is. There's a good look at Gory. She is a wonderful person and a fantastic trainer. And boy, does she know her job. And she is really going to be missed here at Montgomery College. One of the really great Montgomery College people.
You know, I think our friend Christy Mempin is showing her the live stream. I'm not sure she's going to be super happy that we showed that first pitch again. Sorry, Gory. We don't make those decisions.
Well, she was trying to keep it down in the zone.
That's right.
And she just did.
We talk about it all the time. You keep those, you get those pitches up in the zone, they go a long way.
That's for sure. So anyway, that brings up number 21, Tovine Potts. He grounded out his first time up. So he is 0 for 1. So we're in the top of the fourth. He lines it right at Chris Heckhouse. He took about one half step and he gathered it in.
The customary first step back, and then he said, I don't have to go anywhere. You know, Drew Stone finds himself, up 3-1. It looked a little ugly in the first inning. He worked out of a jam in the first inning, and now he's settled down, and it also helps settle a pitcher down when your offense is putting hits together.
And that brings up Trey Allen. And we have a final on that first softball game in the Region 20 tournament. The Raptors coming out on top 15-2. And two grand slams by Special Zeno, the starting pitcher. Boy, you talk about supporting yourself.
By way of California, Special Zeno has really brought something to this Montgomery College softball team this year.
So they get off to a great start in the Region 20 tournament. They're in the driver's seat now. They'll be playing later on this afternoon. Actually, it starts in just a few moments. They're going to be playing the number one seed, Westmoreland. This is a double elimination format, so the Raptors now are guaranteed of playing on Sunday. And Trey Allen walks with one out, and that brings up Nye, the catcher.
Cameron Nye grounded out to shortstop in his first at bat. And let's see Drew Stone go to work on the runner at first base. We've seen his pickoff move surprise some of the Seahawks today.
Yeah, he picked off Julian Lopez last inning.
His first move when he lifts his right leg, I mean, I'm not a balk expert, but I believe that is pushing the envelope a little bit, as long as he doesn't come forward.
So top of the fourth inning. A big day in Montgomery College sports, the doubleheader here, and of course the women's softball team participating in the Region 20 tournament today. We got off track there, but you talk about a program that has really turned around. That women's softball team last year won just one game all year. This year they won 16 in the regular season, and they get off to a great start in the Region 20 tournament. So what a turnaround for that program.
Yeah, could you imagine? They equal their win total of last year on the first day of the tournament. That doesn't make sense. It's not the way it's supposed to be, but it's fantastic.
Well, he's got the head coach, Trudeau, has a very special group of players. I like to call them gamers. I mean, he's got a core of players on that team who've been playing softball their entire lives. And what a difference it's made for that program.
Let's see if Drew Stone can come back against Cameron Nye. He went up 3-0 after giving up the walk to Trey Allen.
And he walks Nye. So back-to-back walks.
And that's the second time he's actually gone back-to-back on bases on balls today. That's his fifth free pass.
Number 12,
and that brings up Taggart Hess. He walked his first time up.
And unlike the Raptors, the Seahawks haven't been able to capitalize on runners in scoring position.
So one out here in the top of the fourth. Again, we are playing a doubleheader today, so the games will be seven innings.
That's a nice curveball.
And again, we have the all-stone battery here. Drew Stone, the pitcher. Jeff Stone, the catcher. That's a special moment. And right in on the fist, he popped him foul. And we understand that the Stone family are here, so It's a special day for them to see both their sons out there. Sets up outside, comes in. There's a fly ball to center field. Here comes Gilbert. It falls in front of him. Comes a throw to third, and it gets away. But again, there's not much foul ground there. And they are going to send him home as the ball, I guess, went into a probably a ground rule, right, about being out of play over there.
That ball went out of play.
So that'll be an RBI single to center field.
And it doesn't matter how little foul ground there is. If it hits out of play, you're getting your base.
And that brings Dan Rasher out of the dugout. Going to take a little trip to the mound as after getting the first out of the inning, he walked the next two hitters. Stone walked the next two hitters, and then Taggart Hess with a bloop single to center to bring home the second run of the ball game.
Yeah, that was that. Nolan Gilbert, you know, took a first step back, as you should, and that ball was pretty much hit in no man's land. And even with a guy as good a speed as Nolan Gilbert has shown, he couldn't catch up to it.
So I think this visit may be more about, all right, we've got men on first and third, we've got just one out. What are we going to do to minimize the damage here? What are we doing on a ball in the to the right side? What are we doing on a ball to the left side? That sort of thing. And that brings up Eldreth, the left fielder. He walked his first time up. So Drew Stone has walked a fair number. Six walks in four innings, not quite four innings, of work for Drew Stone.
Jumps ahead 0-1.
And on second and third, as Hess went to second on the throw, well, the overthrow to third.
Another big backdoor breaking ball from Drew Stone. Catches the outside corner.
So he's quickly up 0-2. One out. And he gets him.
Way to hold on, brother.
So the brother does the other brother a favor as he's caught a little piece of that breaking pitch, but Jeff Stone held on for the second out of the inning. And that brings that sends us back up to the top of the order, and Infante, he's 1-for-2 with two stolen bases and a run scored. So two outs. Top of the fourth inning. Another breaking pitch. He's got that working. Just missed. Tell you what, the Stone brothers look alike too. Of course, we can't get a real good look at Jeff behind the mask there, but they are definitely brothers.
Infante singled on the first pitch of the afternoon and then looked at a strike three in his second at bat.
First time up, he stole second, stole third, and scored on a fielder's choice ground ball. Stays alive. Full count.
Infante wanted to know if indeed he did swing at ball four, and the umpire kindly told him, yes, you did, young man.
And there is, yep, strike three as he caught the inside corner with the breaking pitch. to shut off the rally there by Cecil, hold them to one run. And so after 3.5 innings of play, the Raptors on top 3-2. There we see strike three. And Marcus, let's keep it right here. We've got one more set of baseball memories, and this time we're going to hear from Jeff Stone, Matt Durkin, and Brennan Carn.
Probably my first home run in Cooperstown. Whole family was there and stuff, and I wasn't a power hitter at all, so it was pretty surprising. We got to play. It's like this week-long tournament.
I would say winning the state championship at 8 years old with my old friends.
My favorite baseball memory, going to the World Series last year. That was probably the highlight of my entire baseball career.
Our young man, Drew Stone, hits a home run in Cooperstown. Well, that's pretty cool.
Boy, yeah, you can't beat that memory. And then, of course, Brennan Carn, once again, going back to last year's World Series. I tell you, it is a special time for those guys. And what a great venue that they get to play in down at Kinston. It's a minor league ballpark.
Historic minor league ballpark.
It's very historic. It's a beautiful facility. It's the former home of the Kinston Indians, who were in the Carolina League.
I
know that Kinston is currently in negotiations to get another minor league club there. When I was down there last year, they were talking they told me that city officials were in negotiations with the Astros organization.
And
so
Kinston Indians used to come up here to this area quite often, because when I was working at a newspaper in Woodbridge, Virginia, we covered the Potomac Cannons, and that was one of their Carolina League rivals, Kinston.
So Pedro Mateo leading off for the Raptors here in the bottom of the fourth. He walked and scored his first time up in the second inning. So Romero now into his fourth inning of work, and all the damage against him by the Raptors has happened with two outs. Oh boy, he swung and missed at a pitch that went way outside. It gets away, but not able to hop out of there and get him at first base. So that goes down as a strikeout for Romero, and that brings up Jeff Stone. And he had a two-out RBI double his first time up.
Yeah, he pretty much he started this offensive rally that MC saw with those two runs with the first double to the fence.
He brought in Mateo, who, of course, we just mentioned had walked. And then Stone scored on an RBI double by Naha Garcia. So the game moving right along. Jeff Stone.
Tell you, his brother really worked his way out of a jam in the inning before this.
And that's something that I know Dan Rasch are very happy to see. You know, they're in a stretch here. They're scheduled to play three straight doubleheaders today, tomorrow, and Monday. So he needs to get as many innings out of his starters today as possible.
You know, and you and I have always talked about pitching depth at this level, where you have to go into the tournament weekends. And nice breaking ball from Romero. But you know you have your ace, you have Harry Thomas, but Harry Thomas can't pitch game two, can't pitch game three. You're gonna throw Harry Thomas most likely in your tournament or in your playoffs game one. He's your ace, but where's your number two and where's your number three? So to develop a rotation, with a guy at the number two spot and the number three spot is really important. So to see Andrew Stone holding down a Division II lineup that's got some serious power, that's going to be something that Dan Rasher is going to be able to use come tournament time, to trust Stone to go out there and throw four or five, maybe six innings.
Of course, Dan Rasher is the pitching coach this year. Tyler Klitsch The last couple of seasons been the pitching coach for the Raptors, former Raptor player Tyler Klitsch. This year he's got job responsibilities that have kept him away, so Dan Rasher has been working with the pitching. And there is a swing and a miss for strike three. And so three strikeouts as Romero strikes out the side here in the bottom of the fourth inning. We've played four complete. The Raptors on top 3-2. We'll be right back with more Raptors baseball after this quick break.
With over 3.2 billion people online globally, cybersecurity jobs are in high demand. Montgomery College offers instruction on the latest technology in our state-of-the-art cyber lab. Hands-on experience provides entry-level computer technicians a pathway to enter the workforce or to transfer to a four-year institution. For more information, visit montgomerycollege.edu/cyberprogram.
Montgomery College is a friendly environment.
Great opportunity.
Accessible.
Caring.
Diverse.
Super.
Wow.
Success.
Diverse.
Second home.
Excellent.
Exceptional.
The best.
Simply unforgettable.
Fantabulous.
It's fantastic.
It's great.
Amazing.
Supportive.
Essential.
It's unique.
Inspiring.
And welcome back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. And Marcus, looks like the Raptors have made a pitching change as Eddie O'Neill now into the ball game for the Raptors. That closes the books on Drew Stone. He pitches four innings for the Raptors today.
Eddie O'Neill is the Raptors' number one relief pitcher. He's appeared in 16 games and has a 2-2 record. 29 innings pitched, 32 hits, allowed 22 runs, 12 earned, so he's got a 3.64 ERA. He's got a really kind of an awkward, even lower than a three-quarter delivery. I wouldn't exactly say it's Darren O'Day drag on the knuckles or hit the dirt with your fingers sidearm, but he pretty much comes from third base.
So a completely different look now for Cecil as Julian Lopez leads off for the Seahawks here in the top of the fifth. He's struck out and walked. He was picked off his last time up. Picked off first base by Drew Stone.
I mean, Eddie O'Neill won't know who the heck I'm talking about, but his delivery reminds me a little bit of Jeff Nelson.
There's a fly ball out to center field. Nolan Gilbert over it for the easy catch.
First baseman, number 11.
Only had to go about four or five steps to his left. So one up, one down. That brings up Zeroli. And so far he has walked. And his last time up, he flew out to right field, Chris Heckhouse.
And Coach Rasher brought the righty side armor to come in to pitch against these power hitters like Zeroli. Obviously, Zeroli would probably prefer to have the lefty.
And I would think that Dan Rasher's plan here would be to hopefully have Eddie O'Neill finish this game out. That way he only has to go to his bullpen one time in this opener. Game one of our doubleheader from the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. Raptors on top 3-2. Been a well-played game so far. And the count is full. There's a line shot into the gap, and that's going to make it all the way to the fence. Zeroli legs it into second as the Raptors get it in quickly. It was a little closer than I think he thought it was going to be.
They made a play out of it, but got to credit Joe Zeroli because he was busting it out of the box. But that ball got there quick. It didn't roll around much.
And the Raptors were right on top of it.
Interesting swing by Zeroli. He really, I mean, he's a big guy, 6'4", so he wants to get those arms extended. But he opened up and he closed, he kind of shortened up his swing and got the barrel of the bat on it, surprisingly.
Aha, Garcia got to that ball quickly, made a nice throw in. The Raptors made it close. And that brings up Ripken. He has a fielder's choice ground out RBI, and he also struck out. Leading hitter on the Cecil team, and he slams one into left, and that is over the fence for a home run. So a line drive home run to dead left field, and it got out of here real fast.
You know, and if we see this on replay, you got to hand it to Ripken. He stood his ground against the side armor and just opened up and pulled it. Ball came back into his wheelhouse.
Shortstop number 21, Trey Knox.
And it just got over.
And Eddie O'Neill's pitches to the right-handed batter sort of, they sort of dive back into the batter.
And that brings up Potts.
It would go away against the lefty, but it comes in on the hands against the righty. And if you have time to open up.
And Potts quickly behind in the count, two strikes. He grounded out and flied out, so he's 0 for 2. Last time up, he popped out to Heckhouse in right field. So Cecil very quickly takes the lead here in the top of the fifth on a two-run home run by Nick Ripken after a double by Zeroli, Joseph Zeroli.
You're talking about two guys that have 16 home runs between them. So the Raptors just got bit by two of the best hitters in Maryland.
Yeah, no shame in that.
Actually make that 17 home runs now.
And Potts goes down on a called third. So that's two outs. And that brings up Trey Allen. And he takes a strike.
Nice pitch.
He's Richard Allen the third, and he goes by Trey.
Eddie O'Brien started him off with a fastball outside and came in with the breaking ball.
And there's strike three, and Trey Allen does not like the call at all, but it will stand. It will stand. So after four and a half innings of play, Cecil takes the lead there on a two-run homer by Nick Ripken as we see strike three. And we'll be right back with the bottom half of the fifth after this.
With over 3.2 billion people online globally, cybersecurity jobs are in high demand. Montgomery College offers instruction on the latest technology in our state-of-the-art cyber lab. Hands-on experience provides entry-level computer technicians a pathway to enter the workforce or to transfer to a four-year institution. For more information, visit montgomerycollege.edu/cyberprogram.
You know, Michael, next weekend the Raptors men's and women's outdoor track and field teams head to Westfield, Massachusetts, up to New England for the NJCAA Division III Track and Field Championships. The NJCAA will provide live coverage of the meet this year at flowtrack.org, FLOTRACK.org, and my partner here will be on site providing updates on the Raptors via social media and the Raptors YouTube page. And Michael, MC's track program has definitely, I wouldn't even say anymore that they're on the rise. They've arrived. They are here, and they are good.
Boy, that
and
is.
What can we expect this year other than a bunch of firsts and seconds?
Well, I'll tell you what, we've got at the moment there are 27 athletes. We're seeing some of the footage of them in action this season. 27 athletes, men and women, have qualified so far for nationals. You've got athletes like Brianna Rhodes, who we just saw there in that last clip. She's qualified in the 200 meters, 400 meters, high jump, long jump, 4x1, and 4x4. And, of course, Brianna last year won a national championship as Nolan Gilbert leads things off with a base hit to left field. But anyway, I'm very excited to be going with the team up there, and I look for them to bring home multiple national championships this year. So always a great event, very colorful, a lot of fun, a lot of things going on. I'll tell you one thing, keeps me busy.
And, you know, if you want to follow Michael Brown on Twitter, you can just go to MC_Raptor Voice.
And there's Chris Heckhouse, and he follows it up with a single into left field. So back-to-back singles by the Raptors to lead off the fifth.
That's a way to answer.
And that brings up Eddie Pagero. So the Raptors, two up and two on, two quick singles to left field off of Romero, who has his first lead. Well, actually, I'm sorry, his second lead of the game. The Cecil did jump out to that quick 1-0 lead after a half inning of play.
So did Dan Rasher just talk to Eddie Pagero about sacrifice bunting?
Well, I wouldn't be surprised. Considering the situation, you got good speed on the base paths, and you've got your RBI guys come up, and he does show bunt.
And he pulls the bat back.
Pagero is 0-for-2. He's grounded out and struck out. And he bunts at a ball and fouls it off.
Yeah, that was a tailing fastball. That's a hard bunt for the lefty to put down up around the numbers.
Cecil in at the corners, particularly Zeroli at first.
You got the RBI guy on deck.
And there's strike two. So that probably now takes the bunt out of the equation with two strikes, particularly since he fouled off his first attempt. Of course, a bunt on two strikes, if it goes foul, it's a strikeout. And he swings through it for strike three. Well, that is not what Eddie Pagero wanted to do in that situation. That brings up Stuart Paz. He got on an error in the third and came around to score. He advanced to second on a overthrow. There's a ground ball down the third baseline.
That is a fair ball.
He's going to call it foul. Boy, that sure looked fair to me.
Wow. You know, I thought that went right over the third base bag.
Here's a good look at it.
Went foul. Yep.
Good call by the umpire
good
replay there by the MCTV crew to give us confirmation of the umpire's call.
You know, the home plate umpire has to have quick feet to jump out and look down that line. And
so
he made the call.
Romero quickly ahead 0-2. Boy, Stuart Paz thought he had an RBI double.
Or two.
Sure. Very close.
You know, now he's in the hole 0-2 to a guy that has a little giddy up on his fastball when he wants to.
There's a hard ground ball to short. Nice pick. Over to first, and he's safe at first.
What a pick. You said it.
The designated hitter, number 23. And that brings up Brooks Carson. So the Raptors, boy, nice play there.
You know,
that's short by Potts.
If Potts didn't think for 1 second about going to third, that was an easy double play, because that's about all that Stuart Paz beat it out by, that one split second that Potts looked to third.
And that brings up Brooks Carson. He has a RBI single to center field his last time up. Here he is with two outs, and he hits a fly ball down the left field line, deep. But he got under it for the third out. Yep.
Not enough barrel on that hit.
Just got a little bit under it, a little bit off the handle of the bat. So the Raptors threaten but do not score. And after five complete innings of play, Cecil on top 4-3. We'll be right back. You're watching Montgomery College Baseball on MCTV.
No importa a dónde te diriges, no importa tu edad, encontrarás todo aquí en Montgomery College. Clases pequeñas, horarios flexibles, más de 130 programas de estudio, profesores reconocidos, programa deportivo NJCAA clasificado nacionalmente. Montgomery College. Solicita hoy.
All right, be sure to check out the MC Raptors YouTube channel at youtube.com/TheRaptorsMC. You'll find archives of all the broadcasts we do here at MCTV, tons of highlights, and my partner here, Michael Brown, is a very busy guy, as we just talked about. He'll be up in Westfield, Massachusetts next week. See him at almost every Raptors home game and even a few road games or some national tournaments. He's doing great highlights, putting them on the YouTube channel. And even when we're not here doing a full broadcast, that doesn't mean you can't stay on top of everything that goes on with Montgomery College athletics.
All right, we are ready to start the top half of the sixth inning. And Nye leads it off for Cecil.
Well, that was an exciting inning for the Raptors. Unfortunately, they didn't put fourth the tying run, and that play by Potts at shortstop on that line drive really saved this game from being 4-4.
That's for sure, as the Raptors had two on, nobody out, but couldn't score. So Nye has grounded out and walked so far. Eddie O'Neill back out on the mound for his second inning of work. He gave up the two-run homer last inning to Nick Ripken, and that is the difference in the game so far.
Yeah, he gave up a long double to Zeroli, and Zeroli is one of the best hitters in Maryland. And then Nick Ripken, who's hitting 427, hit the home run.
And there's a strike three. So Nye goes down looking. And that brings up Taggart Hess.
I tell you what, it's really confusing for a right-handed batter to hit against Eddie O'Neill. He's got his fastball dives in on your hands. His curveball kind of comes away from third base and curves over.
Ground ball to second. Pause. Over to first for the out. So two quick outs here in the top of the sixth inning for Eddie O'Neill, and that brings up Eldreth.
Left fielder,
he's
five,
walked
John
and struck
Elvis
out so far today. And there's a fly ball to center field. Nolan Gilbert over, under, and makes the catch for the third out of the inning. So a very quick inning there for Eddie O'Neill. And we have played five and a half innings now. And we're going to take a little break. We'll be right back with the bottom of the sixth coming up next on MCTV.
With over 3.2 billion people online globally, cybersecurity jobs are in high demand. Montgomery College offers instruction on the latest technology in our state-of-the-art cyber lab. Hands-on experience provides entry-level computer technicians a pathway to enter the workforce or to transfer to a four-year institution. For more information, visit montgomerycollege.edu/cyberprogram.
And we're back to Windy Hill on the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. Michael Brown alongside my partner Marcus Rosano. And the Raptors coming up here in the bottom of the sixth. trailing 4-3, and Greg Brown will be leading off for MC.
First baseman, 27, Greg Brown.
And he is due. 0-2 with a couple of ground outs.
Well, they threatened in the inning before this. Let's see if Greg Brown and Mateo on deck can put something together here.
Ibart Romero still out on the hill. He's pitched very well for Cecil. And he's quickly ahead in the count. No balls, two strikes.
You know, he hasn't been dominant, but Romero has done enough to keep his team in the game. He's made some mistakes. The Raptors have made him pay for it a couple of times.
Did a real nice job last inning to get out of what looked like a Raptors rally in the making when they got the first two runners on. Nobody out. But Tovine Potts with that great stop at shortstop to keep things keep Cecil ahead, and Greg Brown goes down swinging to lead off the inning.
I tell you what, when Romero wants to muscle up and throw the ball by somebody, he can.
And he just blew that one by him. That brings up Mateo. He's walked and scored and struck out. Leading hitter on the Raptors team. Of course, he's certainly capable of tying this thing up with one swing of the bat. Goes right through that one.
High and hard. Pedro probably wants that one back.
First of two here from the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. And again, at the NJCAA level, when you play a doubleheader, both games are 7 innings long. That one gets back, almost hit the R in Raptor behind home plate. There is strike three. So Romero with another strikeout.
Catcher, number 31, Jeff Stone.
Wow, I've counted 9.
That is 9 strikeouts, and there it is. Boy, that's a pretty pitch. Wow. And that brings up Naha Garcia. I'm sorry, Jeff Stone. That brings up Jeff Stone. He's got a RBI double, and he struck out.
Ooh,
and he just got hit by a pitch.
And that curveball didn't have any bite.
Certainly not on purpose. Last thing Romero wanted to do was put a runner on with 2 outs here in the bottom of the 6th.
Nice show, a show of sportsmanship from the pitcher as he took a look over at Stone at first base and said, "My fault."
I think Stone, probably better than anybody, understands how a pitch like that can get away from a pitcher.
Well, he's a catcher. He'll take a curveball on the back anytime.
Oh, yeah. And, of course, the Raptors need base runners. Trailing by 1, Garcia has doubled and struck out. Has an RBI. He fouls it straight back. It got stuck in the fence there. Bottom of the 6th, 2 outs.
Naha is in the hole, 0-2.
And it seems like Romero has been pitching from that vantage point now for the last 2-3 innings. He's really gotten stronger.
Wow.
And that is strike 3 as Garcia goes down looking. So the Raptors do not score here in the bottom of the sixth. We have played six complete. The Raptors trailing the Seahawks 4-3. We'll be right back with the top of the seventh after this quick break.
My favorite thing about Montgomery College is their commitment to excellence.
The support that we have from our teachers and our colleagues is amazing.
They really wanted me to pursue my goals and to graduate and to go beyond.
The small class sizes and everything was very hands-on.
Our teachers are hands-on on the students. They are there and they are available at any time.
They just want you to succeed. I love everything about Montgomery College.
And welcome back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. And we hope you'll stick with us after this game because there's still lots more baseball to be played. Game two of our doubleheader will be coming up approximately a half hour after the completion of this game. And Bryce Swan is going to be on the hill in game two for the Raptors. And we have a new pitcher out there on the hill for Montgomery College. It's Cayman Hatton, number eight. Really the Raptors closer so far this year. There you can see he's got eight saves, Marcus, second in NJCAA D3.
And he has quite the delivery. He sort of jumps off the mound, goes almost full sidearm. So we're going from Eddie O'Brien sidearm to Cayman Hatton sidearm. But he's full of motion. So when he comes at you, it's kind of hard to pick up the ball. You can just see it right out of his, coming right out of his hand. His body is still moving, so that's got to be hard to pick up for the opposing batter.
Well, I asked him about his peculiar motion. He told me that he started throwing that way just 2-3 years ago in Legion ball, and he said a coach suggested it. He gave it a shot, and he said he really likes it. It's much easier on the arm.
That's right, and he is a closer, so he can go out and use that herky-jerky motion for one inning or two innings.
So
I'm not sure he could stand up and do that seven innings in a given game.
I've never seen a motion quite like it. There's a lot of energy out there for Cayman Hatton. So he is back at the top of the order, Infante leading off.
Well, the stats don't lie, so he's doing something right.
Infante struck out his last two times up. He singled his first time up.
And the first pitch he started off was a really slow curveball, and it almost looks like his motion is faster than the ball.
So Cayman Hatton. Alexandria, Virginia, Edison High School. General studies major. And he's a sophomore.
And then if the elbows and knees and body isn't enough, he's got the hair.
Yeah, he's got it all going on. And there is strike three. So Infante goes down for his third straight strikeout.
Second baseman number four, Julian.
And that brings up Julian Lopez. And he's looking for his first hit this afternoon. He's struck out, walked, and flew out to center field his last time up. When he walked back there in the third inning, he was subsequently picked off by Drew Stone. Drew Stone started for the Raptors, went four. He will not be the pitcher of record. When he left the ballgame, the Raptors were on top. Right now, the pitcher of record for Montgomery College is Eddie O'Neill. So we are in the top of the seventh, and this could be the final inning of game one.
Had ourselves a brief game. We're looking at about an hour and 45 minutes at this point.
There's a ground ball, hard ground ball to Peguero. He bobbles it. He's got time. And a nice pickup there by Greg Brown. Ball was hit hard.
That was a nice stab by Greg Brown.
First baseman, number 11, Joe
And that Zeroli. Brings up Joe Zeroli.
Yeah, a nice play for Piguero to keep the ball in front of him at least.
Had the time. But a nice play there by Greg Brown at first base. So Zeroli, he doubled his last time up to the wall in left field and then trotted home on the subsequent two-run homer by Nick Ripken. And that is the difference in the ball game at the moment. Hard ground ball foul down third baseline. So that evens the count at one. One ball, one strike. Kamen Hatton on the hill for the Raptors, the third Raptors pitcher of game one. Again, a reminder, game two of our doubleheader coming up right after this one, about 30 minutes. Outside. In case you're joining us late, the Raptors softball team playing this weekend in the Region 20 softball tournament. And they jumped out. They won their first game 15-2 over Anne Arundel. There's a hard ground ball single into left field.
Another good piece of hitting by Joe Zeroli.
So his last two times up, he has really stung the ball. So a two-out single.
That's not easy to do against Kamen Hatton, where Joe Zeroli really stood his ground. I mean, the ball looks like it's coming at you, and he stood his ground, and it got about around the inside of the plate, and he just turned on it.
And Ripken. Takes a strike. Ripken has three RBIs in the game for Cecil. Brought home the first run on a fielder's choice single, and then, of course, he had the two-run homer his last time up, and that's the difference in the ball game.
Yeah, Kamen Hatton's got to be real careful right now. Another slow-breaking pitch. Jumps out 0-2 on this big power hitter.
And this guy... he'd love another shot at a fastball, I'm sure. Top of the seventh inning. Kamen Hatton on the hill, and there is strike three as he got him waving at that one for the third out.
And Ripken is just shaking his head like, what did I just see?
What did I just swing at? And we're going to keep it right here as we're getting ready for the bottom of the seventh. And this, Marcus, this will be the Raptors' last opportunity here in game one.
Well, they send Ramiro back to the hill so he can attempt to go complete game. But he's, you know, he hasn't lost anything off his fastball. He's come back and gotten out of jams when he needed to by just powering up and throwing that fastball. He's shown that he's got a pretty good breaking ball. But the Raptors have also shown that they can hit his mistakes.
Well, he's avoided any damage the last three innings. The last time the Raptors scored was in the bottom of the third. He's gotten stronger. He's been ahead in the count a lot in the last two, three innings. He's really kind of had the Raptors eating out the palm of his hand. Now he's going to face the number nine hitter in the order, who is certainly not your prototypical number nine hitter in Nolan Gilbert. He'll lead things off. And then it'll be Chris Heckhouse and then Piguero as the Raptors with their last opportunity here. Gilbert singled his last time up, and he struck out his first time up. And in case you joined us late, This is his first action in quite some time. He his foot was in a cast for several weeks as he had an off-the-field accident.
Here we saw Romero go 0-2 again. You know the importance of those first pitch strikes. It's the numbers are unbelievable of pitchers that have first pitch strikes and the success rates that they have.
And it's 100 pitches so far for Romero. Boy, that one was really high.
That was coming our way,
fast.
Buddy.
And strike three.
On the breaking ball.
On the breaking ball. So another strikeout for Romero. That's his 10th. I'm sorry, let me double check that. 11 strikeouts for Romero, and that brings up Chris Heckhouse. And he swings and misses at the first pitch.
Yeah, he hasn't lost any pop on his fastball from anyone. I think he actually got a little stronger around the fourth or fifth.
Yeah, I feel like he has. Chris Heckhouse is 1-for-3. He singled his last time up. The Raptors put two on with nobody out in the top of the fifth, but that might have been Romero's best pitching job of the day as he got out of that one unscathed.
And here we are 0-2 again.
And there's a ground ball up the middle for a base hit as it finds a hole.
I'm surprised Romero really gave him something over the plate there, jumping out 0-2, and he didn't waste any pitches. And Heckhouse had to protect, and he had a ball fairly high, right in a hitter spot.
So that puts Chris Heckhouse on first, and I'm sure Cecil doesn't need to be reminded. They need to keep an eye on him. Chris leads the Raptors in steals. He's got 13 steals, so I wouldn't be surprised to see him running here.
Yeah, we haven't really seen Romero work too much from the stretch. And we don't know what kind of pickoff move he has.
There's a breaking pitch high. Eddie Peguero up for the Raptors. He's 0-for-3 so far. A couple of strikeouts and a ground out.
And Romero shortened up his delivery those first two pitches with the guy on first.
And Peguero swings and misses. So Romero again ahead in the count, 1-2. Well, he's the ace of the Cecil staff, and he has shown why today. Peguero fouls it off, stays alive. Chris Heckhouse on first with a one-out single. And Peguero swings and misses for strike three, and that is two outs.
What a curveball. That thing started off in the middle of the plate and finished right below Eddie Peguero's knees.
And that brings up Stuart Paz, and he represents the last Raptor opportunity here as we are in the bottom half of the seventh inning. Again, this is because it's a doubleheader, this is a seven-inning ball game. So the Raptors need to get something going here, or we'll be wrapping this up and going to game two. There's a foul back. So once again, he's ahead in the count. No balls, two strikes.
O-2 again. It's somewhat fitting for Romero.
Seen that count a lot. And Chris Heckhouse steals second base.
Little defensive indifference there because it doesn't look like the catcher was really going to make a play at Cameron Nye.
No. Now runner in scoring position. So let's see if Stuart Paz can pick him up. There's a ground ball to short. Takes a bad hop. Potts with the long throw. It gets away. And here comes Chris Hackhouse with the tying run. And oh my goodness, what a turn of events. And Stuart Paz looks to me like he's hurt down there at first, holding his quad. And,
it looks like he's
not sure if he landed funny on the base or what happened there.
But,
let's get another look at that play.
Potts basically saved the game a couple innings ago, and that ball took a strange hop, and Potts had to field it, but he had a little bit of I think he caught a cleat and threw himself off balance. But at the same time, the first baseman didn't come off the bag to make a play on the ball. I tried to stay on the bag and make the game-ending out, and obviously that didn't work. It wasn't a good combination.
So
there we have it. It's 4-4.
It's 4-4, just like that. As Romero was down to Stuart Paz was down to his last strike, Romero shaking his head like, I cannot believe I'm still out here on the mound. And this thing isn't over yet, as we've got Brooks Carson coming to the plate. And as the leading home run hitter on the Raptors, leading RBI man on the Raptors, he is more than capable of ending this thing. We're going to keep an eye on Stuart Paz, who looks like he's moving okay now. He may have caught a cleat in the mud. Not sure what happened down there at first base as he was streaking down the line to try to beat out that ground ball to shortstop. Whew. Romero now, I think, pitching with a little bit of an anger in him.
I would say.
Yeah.
I mean, and Brooks Carson knew what was coming and couldn't catch up to that.
So, again, Romero quickly ahead, no balls and two strikes. So the Raptors, with two outs, down to their last strike. And there's a...
I think they called a balk on him.
And they did. They call a balk on Romero, and he doesn't agree with the call at all. As he is...
I think he's just so mad that he didn't even really pause. I mean, he's pitching from the stretch, obviously.
Get a real quick look here. And see what happened. That ball gets away. Paz is going to move to third. So they called the balk. I'm not a balk expert, Marcus. You're going to have to explain that one to me.
I can't explain it. I don't think he came to a set. I think he just wanted. At this point, Romero wants to throw the ball through the catcher's glove.
So Paz has moved up, and then he gets him on the strikeout on the high heat. So Brooks Carson goes down swinging, but the Raptors tie it up at four. We're going to go to extras. We'll be right back with the top of the eighth after this.
No matter where you're headed, no matter what your age, you'll find it all here at Montgomery College. Small class sizes, flexible scheduling, over 130 programs of study, award-winning faculty, nationally ranked NJCAA athletics. The possibilities are endless at Montgomery College. Register today for summer session classes.
And we're back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College, where we just saw a very strange bottom of the seventh inning. The Raptors were down to their last strike, trailing 4-3. A fairly routine ground ball to shortstop ends up scoring the tying run.
You know, we're doing a doubleheader television game on a Saturday. Of course things are going to get strange. They tend to do that.
And
we were talking about how economical the game was, and now we're right back to where we started.
All tied up at four, And Kamen Hatton still on the mound for the Raptors, and that brings up number 21, Tovine Potts, who made the error that that kept this ball game going. I mean, there's no other way to call it. I feel bad for the young man.
He's played a good game.
He really has. He saved the game, as you correctly pointed out, back in the fifth inning when the Raptors had runners two on, nobody out, and he made a great play at shortstop to save what clearly would have been the tying run then. So, strange twist of fate for Tovine Potts as we are into the top half of the eighth inning now. Kamen Hatton on for his second inning of work, and Potts ground ball to Mateo, goes to his knees, gets it, picks it up, and another nice play.
What?
Another great backhand play by
fantastic.
Greg Brown.
And he was actually in foul territory when he made that play, and to not only get the pick but to keep your foot on the bag, that was a heck of a play by Greg Brown.
Nice play by Mateo to keep it in front of him, but the throw was way short. But Greg Brown, wow. Nice stretch, kept the toe on the bag, and that was a two-hopper that he backhanded.
And you have a guy barreling down the first baseline, so it takes some guts to put your entire body in the line of an oncoming train.
And that brings up Trey Allen, the third baseman. And he is 0-for-2 with a walk. He did score a run. So top of the eighth inning, the Raptors tying it up in the bottom of the seventh with two outs and two strikes on Stuart Paz. And he brings home Chris Heckhouse, who had singled. And nice strikeout there by Kamen Hatton. So Allen goes down on strikes.
Yeah, and your closer is in for his second inning of work. So he can go from a save situation, well, not a save situation, but he can get himself a win if the Raptors score in the bottom of the inning.
And that brings up the catcher, Nye. And he's 0-for-2 with a walk. Ground out, strikeout. And he pops it up into short right field. Chris Heckhouse in under it and gathers it in for the third out. So a 1-2-3 inning there for Kamen Hatton. So after 7.5 innings of play, we're still tied at 4. We'll be right back with the bottom of the eighth after this.
With over 3.2 billion people online globally, cybersecurity jobs are in high demand. Montgomery College offers instruction on the latest technology in our state-of-the-art cyber lab. Hands-on experience provides entry-level computer technicians a pathway to enter the workforce or to transfer to a four-year institution. For more information, visit montgomerycollege.edu/cyberprogram.
New pitcher. And we are back to the Germantown campus of Montgomery College. We have a new pitcher out there. You may have heard me say that already, as Edwin Lopez has come into the game for Cecil.
And Edwin Lopez is a relief pitcher because he's pitched in 10 games. He has no wins, no losses. Decent numbers, 13 innings pitched, 13 hits. He's got a 2.7 ERA. He's struck out 11 batters in those 13 innings. Only given up 4 earned runs. And a pretty good walk to strikeout ratio. 11 Ks, 3 bases on balls.
So that ends the day for Ibart Romero. And I mean, you got to say, we're obviously Montgomery College television and all, but Ibart Romero certainly deserved a better fate.
Absolutely. I mean, what did he have, 12 strikeouts?
12 strikeouts.
And, this is a good lineup. And other than the second and the third inning, he was basically pitching himself to a quality win. And one thing leads to another, and that's why it's baseball. It takes a bad hop. A slick fielding shortstop was thrown off by a bad hop and made a bad throw, and your tying run came around to score.
So Greg Brown, who's made a couple of really fine defensive plays at first base, including one last inning, leads things off for the Raptors. And he is 0-for-2 with a strikeout. I'm sorry, he's 0-for-3. Two ground outs and a strikeout. So Romero finished for the game, pitches 7 very strong innings. And the Raptors tied things up in the bottom of the 7th. So we have a new pitcher out there in Lopez. He's a sophomore. And there is a softly hit ground ball to second, over to first, and he dropped it. Sort of a humpback ground ball line drives combination there out onto the right field grass. Second baseman sort of nonchalanted that throw, I thought.
You know, I think he knew he had Greg Brown running and he had time.
And
Zarelli had a chance to make the pick, and he didn't make the pick, but it wasn't a good throw, of course.
So
got a Greg Brown pinch runner.
Got a pinch runner for Greg Brown.
I'm going to give that error to the second baseman.
And there's a bunt. Back to Lopez, he bobbles it, throws it to first, but the sacrifice works as the Raptors runner, and I have not picked up his number yet.
Number one
in your hearts and number one in your
Daniel
program.
Daniel Kern.
And that is Daniel Kern.
You know, you got to hand it to Dan Rasher. You got yourself a power hitter with 7 home runs, and you just asked him to lay down a bunt, and he laid down a perfect sacrifice.
To get the runner to second, and that brings up Jeff Stone, who has an RBI double today.
That was a big hit. That really got Montgomery College going in the second inning.
He had a 2-out RBI double in the second inning, as the Raptors have scored all of their runs after 2 outs, including the tying one in the bottom of the 7th. So they've been a resilient team today. But you would expect nothing less from a Dan Rasher coach team. There are no meaningless games. There are no games that don't matter as much as others. Stone waves at that one, and they call that one a strike. So Lopez ahead in the count. Kern at second. He's pinch running for Chris Brown. I'm sorry, Greg Brown.
Nice curveball. Kind of snuck around the inside of the plate. Didn't quite get the plate. Seahawks wanted it. Kern has a nice healthy lead. Off second.
Big opportunity here for Jeff Stone. It's in the dirt. Gets away. Kern now into third base.
You know, good read by Kern, because Cameron Nye, the catcher, was looking behind him, as he should, because that's where most of the balls go when they get past the catcher. But it was sitting in front of the batter's box. You'll see this replay.
He kept it in front of him, and you're right. Normally that ball would get by. And Kern motors into third, so he's now 90 feet away. And Stone walks.
And now you don't even need a hit. Get yourself a sacrifice fly. And it's Naha Garcia.
Naha Garcia, who has an RBI double today. He had a ringing double to left field.
He did, and he got some good flight on that ball. So now he doesn't have to even do it for a base hit.
With less than two outs, there's a multitude of ways for the Raptors to score here.
And they're going to walk him, Michael. They're going to load him up.
And that'll leave it up to Nolan Gilbert, who has a nice, who has a smile on his face. He's thinking, man, my first game back after missing 30-plus games with injury, I've got a shot at winning this thing. So Naha Garcia is going to get the free pass. That will load the bases with one out. Of course, that sets up a force at any base.
He's not going to be easy to double up. So if there is a comebacker, you're obviously coming home, you know, to get that runner from third. But again, with the bases loaded, you have a lot of options.
And the middle infielders are now back at double play depth. The corners are in. Try to cut the run off at the plate on anything to first or third. And that brings up Nolan Gilbert, who's 1-for-3 on the day against Lopez. And he takes a strike.
Nice pitch. Really a strikeout right now, other than double play, but he really just wants to put the ball in play and let something happen.
Let his fielders. And Gilbert swings and misses.
I'm not sure if that's a slider, but it's a real quick cutting breaking ball. He started
Nasty.
Him off inside with the fastball.
Nasty looking pitch. So he's ahead in the count. No balls and two strikes. There's Gilbert, ground ball off the pitcher. He bobbles it, and that is the ball game. As he grounds it off, hard shot off the pitcher, and he cannot make the play, and the Raptors win on a ball that maybe traveled 25 feet, if that. And the Raptors pull it out. It looked like a certain loss for the Raptors in game one of the doubleheader, but we're going to get another look at it. It's a hard shot off the glove of Lopez.
Really, that is exactly what Cecil wanted, a comebacker to the mound. You could have come home, got the lead runner, and then gone back to first to complete the double play and get out of the inning. But, you know, this is baseball. It hit the pitcher's glove. He went to get it again because he still had the runner coming down, barreling down from third, and he just couldn't pick it up. So a really crazy, strange end to that game. And you got a feel for the Seahawks, ace, Jaiber Romero, who really got a raw deal here. And next thing you know, we're looking at Dan Rasher saying, nice win.
Cayman Hatton gets the win for the Raptors. He pitches two scoreless innings for Montgomery College as they really got a fine pitching effort today from Drew Stone, who started things off for them. Pitched well for four strong innings. And then Cayman Hatton, Eddie O'Neill had a little bit of a rough go there in his couple innings of work. Cayman Hatton comes in, pitches the last two to get the win. An improbable victory for the Raptors here in game one. And once again, stick with us as that one, game one goes into the books. The Raptors come out on top 5-4. But don't go anywhere. Game two is coming up in approximately 30 minutes. Stick with us. Marcus and I'll be right back with all the action. You're watching Montgomery College Baseball on MCTV.